Hello guys, and welcome to episode 8 of my Total War Warhammer playthrough, playing as Chaos. And today, well, we're going to be moving on with Archaon and Sigvald towards Kislev, since Varg didn't last very long against Ailing. And yeah, that's where we're going to head. We're probably going to head over to Kislev, wipe them out. That gets rid of a nation that the Empire can take over. And then we'll probably just go straight for, like, the dwarves over here. Currently, it's just Karak Kadrin, but I'm pretty sure they are the first faction that gets in a confederation with the dwarves normally, so we'll probably see that happen at some point. But in the meantime, let's get to Mar to deploy this turn, since he needs to do so in order to advance our quest. I think it is, yeah, the Eye of Shirion. We got to deploy the Chaos Sorcerer, and that will advance that quest. We can already do the Slayer of Kings battle, and we can do the Armor of Morka battle after we get the Chaos Knight with Lances. But yeah, the Slayer of Kings one, enemy forces, they have Chaos Warriors, Chaos Chariots, Chaos Knights, and Hell Cannons. Ideally, what I want to do is probably actually recruit Chaos Knights before I do any of those battles. It's going to take me a little while before that happens. Currently we are only on population surplus 2, and we need 10, there you go, to get Chaos Knights, really. It's going to cost me a lot of money as well. I think that's like the only building that gives us upkeep as well, or gives us money, sorry. So there we go, right. So Prince Sigvald has all of Archaon's castaways now. I think everything else is done for this turn, so let's move on to the next one. So you can see there, Middenheim under attack by a couple of my vassals. Scaling also all the way down there, ailing in the top right near Prague. And Musalon still moving around in the lands up north. Right, ambusher discovered. Quest successful, the Eye of Shirion. And let's move that on. So, twisted in body and mind, the sorcerer twitches convulsively in the grip of the gods and howls a vision of mountains twisted into fantastical shapes with gaping maws jutting out of cliff faces, bellowing to be fed the flesh of mortals. Before the mountains lies a blood-stained plain, bordered by forests of trees contorted into blackened skeletons, straining their branches towards warm-blooded creatures. In the tumultuous skies overhead, winged death swoops. A once noble ruler of the skies, now corrupt with change, a two-headed dragon of chaos trumpets its challenge. Okay, that was quite a mouthful. But there we go, I have Shirion quest now available. Let's have a look at the enemy forces. Oh my god, 4 Hell Cannons, really? Okay, I'm definitely going to wait until I have a Chaos Knight so I can actually run those down pretty quickly. I could obviously do it with Marauder Horsemen, just sending all the Marauder Horsemen maybe to attack. We also have a couple of Gorby's Chariots, but I don't know, maybe if like we flanked with Marauder Horsemen and Chaos Warhounds to kill the Hell Cannons. Maybe we could pull that off. And then we do have plenty of, like, Chosen to take care of their Forsaken and Chaos Warriors. And we should have a Chaos Warriors with Halberds to take care of the Chaos Trolls. And then we'll just get Archaon to take on the Giant. We could make that work, but the other thing is that they do have reinforcements. So I'd much rather have, like, 8 units of Chaos Knights, or 7 units of Chaos Knights, then, you know, all the crap that we have right now.
You dare.
Right, this turn we're gonna fast move Prince Sigvald. I keep saying fast move when it's actually march. I've just got that habit from Wargame. And yeah, anyway, Tamar's done his job, so I think what I'm gonna do is bring him up towards Prague. We'll try and get him some experience. And eventually I want to embed him in an army, so preferably in one of these. Well, I mean, we only have two armies, so not much to choose from, but Sigvald actually has a space free, so we'll probably put him in there. So we're sitting on 76,000 cash at the moment. Quite a big reserve. But I think it's needed for now, at least. And I think soon Sigvald should have enough population surplus to build the Dragon Ogre gathering, which will unlock Kolek, and then we'll make him into a third army. So that's what I'm waiting for, and that's what I'm saving my cash for. But that's all again done for this turn. We're waiting for Archeon to build the Hell Cannons. Musulon's still moving around a little. Scaling's still doing their thing. I actually think Scaling hates us at the moment. Yeah. That could actually be an issue. I don't know why Aesling doesn't like me very much. It says we've broken treaties with Aesling and we've had military actions against Aesling. Is that just, like, in the whole game? They just keep that grudge? Not sure. Anyway, it's deteriorating. As with Scaling, well, our military actions against Scaling are off the charts right now. But our total attitude currently improving. I might actually want to assist that, possibly, with a gift.
These dogs! Present yourselves so I may put you out of your misery!
We'll probably go for a medium gift, not a generous gift, because I don't really want to give them 30k. But 8k will do. Hopefully that will help us improve that even more.
Who are these grotesque?
Anyways, Prince Sigvald, I might actually move him on 75%. And encamp this turn. Just so he can get some more replenishment. Archeon's going to finish the Hell Cannons this turn. And Tamar is still on his way, so I think what I'm going to do first is just try and assassinate this guy. That's actually a failure, but leveled him up. We're going to go for Searing Doom if we're going to put him in the army. And we'll end the turn.
Yes. Bow before he who wields the Slayer of Kings.
That's actually quite an amusing quote from Archeon. Because he doesn't wield the Slayer of Kings just yet. We are going to give them 2,600 to keep them happy. And actually, like I said at the beginning of the episode, that did actually just happen. The Dwarves confederated Karak Kidrin, or Kadrin. That's actually quite amusing. The predictions are real. Okay, so we'll move on again with Prince Sigvald.
Moving, father.
And this province must be getting loads of chaos corruption. Yeah, 66% now. That's mental. Surely they can't be holding their public order up. They got plus 14 at the moment just because they got this massive army in that province. But as soon as they take it out, that's going to go into minus. Because the corruption's giving them minus 7. You take away the 8 from military presence. Oh, actually, of course, the difficulty level gives them a plus 8 public order per turn. So, so chaos corruption is pretty much useless. I completely forgot about that. Yeah, because we're never actually going to cause a rebellion. Because it's plus 8 all the time. We're going to need to have literally like 100% chaos corruption in a province in order to like cause a chaos rebellion. That's quite silly. Oh well. I guess this turn we can actually just force move or just march Archaon all the way forwards, because he hasn't suffered from any attrition since he just rebuilt all of his units. So he doesn't have to hang about.
My magic is yours.
Tamar this turn, gonna go for another 19% positive outcome, possibly. anything else we can do, actually, maybe on this army. Just need anything with like a high outcome, like 40% positive outcome. Okay, so there you go.
Ready.
Because if we do get the positive outcome, that gives us a lot more experience.
Witness my beam.
So yeah, Sigvald goes into camp stance and we'll end the turn.
Come, counts. Abase yourselves then.
And here we have well, vampire counts declaring war on me. Scaling actually likes the vampire counts. That's not good. He actually refused to join. Okay, that's an issue. I guess we're going to have to head back with one of these armies, and it's probably going to be Sigvald. Because I want to keep Archaon on the charge. We're going to move him into normal stance as we move into Kislev's territory. And yeah, we're going to have to just march back. So, fortunately, Scaling only has one province, which allows us to take control of him again pretty easily. It's just irritating that I'm going to have to send back Sigvald that whole way. But hopefully once he gets a Dragon Ogre building, what I can do is just recruit Kolek with Archaon and have another, like a second army to accompany him again. Oh, I didn't do anything with Tamar, that was my bad.
Possibly.
And the dwarves are declaring on me as well. We declare war. Well, that's a simple way to put it. So now when we get Scaling back, they'll join us in both those wars as our vassal. What a joke though. Hopefully that assault unit's action didn't succeed, because that's probably what the AI did. Wow, Muzalon's army there getting wrecked. That was really nice. Okay, so we're just going to bring Archaon next to Prague. And I'm just going to keep him in basically raiding stance. Simply because...
You have my favor.
What does that do? Gives extra minus public order. Minus growth. Immune to attrition. Bigger in battle will be winded though. Hmm. Maybe we'll just go for... normal stance. Then we can help with the attack on Prague if they do it. So we'll just chill out near Prague for now. I'm going to try possibly to assassinate one of these characters. That's 23% outcome. Failure. Oh well. So we're going to get Gehenna's Golden Hounds. That's very similar to Orion's Hounds from the Wood Elves. So, pretty much seen that before. It's basically the Hounds are gold instead of purple. Okay, so Sigvald, I don't need to worry about like encamping him anywhere, because as soon as he gets back into friendly territory, he's going to start replenishing anyway. So it's just a race, really, to get to Grayling Moot before the Scaling does any damage to my allies, but... We'll see. We'll see what happens. And Archaon can just chill. Kind of annoying. But I don't really want to like go and attack a massive army with Archaon, get him low and then like end up being attacked by the vampire counts and the empire and all sorts. You can see that Kislev's army is there out in the field. He did just actually move back again. Mussolon gonna move forwards with two massive armies, and here goes the attack onto Prague. Okay, so we're just gonna auto resolve that. Plenty of free loot. I'm gonna get more favor from that as well. Hostile hero activity, critical failure, nice. A follower gained, captives after battle. A weapon gained, causes fear and causes terror, nice. Supernatural prowess has been completed, which gives us extra melee attack for Chaos Warrior, aspiring champion and chosen units. And now I guess what we're going to do is possibly move on to Pledge of the Dark Gods. Because since we have plus 3 unit experience already, if I take this one, plus 2 unit experience for Chaos Knights and Chosen units, when I recruit my Chaos Knights and future Chosen units, they will start with level 5 unit rank, which is crazy. So that's going to cost me 20k, take us pretty low. But we're going to do that anyway. And I'm going to raise Prague for free, since it was just attacked by Isling. And that's going to leave Archeon stranded for now.
Are you a god?
Right, let's try and assassinate this chap again. Success! Okay, nice. Okay, loads of experience for this Chaos Sorcerer. He hasn't got a critical failure yet, so that's basically the best we're going to ask for. Let's end the turn. Everything done. Just constantly skipping these turns, simply because there aren't any big battles to fight, although one with Kislev is very likely in the future. Did Mussolon just lose their armies? I think they might have. So technology researched. Now we're moving on to Slaves to Darkness. Right, and with Prague taken down, Aesling is going to go do their thing elsewhere. And what I'm going to do is move into this territory here. And maybe we'll raid. I'm going to encamp this turn. And that's going to start giving them plus 5% corruption. If we also raid, maybe we can get it to the point where they lose public order, but currently they have plus 20 due to military presence. Spoilers come. Now Prince Siegfeld is going to come to Grayling Moot. Let us go. I guess that's one thing that the Chaos don't actually ever have to deal with, which is his public order, which is actually really nice. Kind of makes them good for a very hard playthrough, because otherwise we would get a penalty to our public order due to the difficulty level, which would be really, really irritating. Let's go, can we assault garrison maybe? The chance is too low, so we're just going to move in here. And we're going to deploy for this turn. That should actually bring him up to level 4. Because he is very close in terms of experience. Right, let's end the turn. Now, after we've dealt with Kislev, what I'm going to do is deal with Hochland, although it looks like Ailing might do that for me. Currently scaling, moving towards another settlement. But Kislev, the ruinous powers demand a large sacrifice of blood. The altars must be drenched in it, or we will suffer a loss of favour. So we've got minus income from whore building, sacking settlements and post-battle loot, but we've got extra leadership and melee attack. Okay, so maybe we should siege this. Although they have a huge garrison. They have a massive... If I attack this, right, with just Archeon, we're going to be outnumbered, like, easily 2-1. And we do have some very good units in the Chosen, but we don't necessarily have enough to deal with their outriders.
Absolutely not.
And since they have so many of them, they're just going to skirmish us to death. So just gotta be really careful. So, passive ability, metal shifting. Around self and allies in range, plus 4% armor piercing damage. Wow, okay, yeah, definitely. Right, Prince Sigvald. The turn after next. Gonna hit Grayling Moot. This your army here might try and attack Pack Ice Bay. But there's only, four troops there? Pacos Bay has a garrison of like 9 units, so they shouldn't win that. Please don't troll me, AI. Now, another thing I have to worry about is, do I have enough turns to just be sitting around with Archaon? Probably not. So what I'm actually going to do is move towards Zavastra. Just so I can get some cash from sacking these settlements. Hochland is nowhere nearby with their forces, so we can take advantage of that. Kislev's currently sitting there with their massive army. And if they bring it out towards Prague, I'm just going to roll back in there and take them out. So we'll see what happens. But we can't, hang around, because in 10 turns, or just over 10 turns, 11 turns, we're going to run out of cash. So,
now,
yeah. We might get some from Grayling Moot, actually. That's a good point. I am going to sack it. And then take it. So let's see where Hochland go. They're moving back to Middenheim, thanks to Biersenling. Biersenling took out Castle von Rauchen. Scaling have gone onto water with our army, so that's fine. We're going to attack Grayling Moot. Water resolve this. Probably should have put the banner on, but doesn't matter. So we're going to sack it. Then we're going to grab him, go back there, and subjugate. Nice. Job done. So now we have Scaling in a battle against the vampires and the dwarves. An extra ally. Definitely worth going back for. We're going to go for Chaos Vanguard again here.
Who are these grotesque creatures?
Okay, and now we can basically move our way all the way back to Kislev. Gonna take a while, but definitely worth going back to assure we have that vassal. So, Khan Humongous, what is he gonna go for? Tempted to get, like, inspirational for the minus 15% recruitment cost, because likely what's going to happen at some point is I'm going to recruit a load more new units into Archaon's army after I give some to Kolak. I could also head towards getting him a Manticore. He is level 18 now, so I think he can get one. So yeah, I think I might do that. Show you guys a Manticore. That would be really awesome. So we're going to take Archaon. We're going to attack Zavastra. We're just going to raise it because that's worth nothing. Aisling taking all my money. that's quite frustrating. I guess we're going to go for the dwarves then. Karak Ungor is looking particularly tasty. If I select Archaon and hover the settlement, it should tell us how much that's worth. 20,000. Yes, indeed. We are going to head towards them for sure. Okay, let's attack or try and assassinate this character. That was a failure. Got some experience for it though. Right, so Sigvald is on his way back. Gonna end the turn. So the other thing I'm worried about is obviously the vampire counts attacking me. They do have a huge army there. Oh, looks like then we might be able to ambush them if they stay in force march. That will give us an easy battle. So block army success to Archaon, which is why they force marched there. God damn. I guess we're just going to move. Maybe we can just move towards Bechafen. I'm going to make sure I get across this river, and then we're going to encamp That will give us immunity to attrition, at least. Then maybe we can siege Pechafen, but the thing is with Pechafen is it is a walled settlement with a very large garrison.
Your order is dismissed.
Well, there's Balthazar Gelt here. He's come up, taking a lot of attrition on the way. So Siegfeld, come on old chap, make your way downtown. He's walking fast and he's homebound. And Tamar, what are you gonna do? I really want to get rid of this banshee if it's gonna keep blocking my armies, but for now, I'm just gonna damage that building to get a successful action, and then we can level them up again. So we'll go for Glittering Robe. That's actually a really nice spell. It gives us leadership and armor. So it basically buffs up a unit that's about to rout, is pretty much what it's good for. End the turn there, see if we get attacked. I mean, it's quite likely that we might at some point. Okay, they've gone back into Pechafen. Right, Biersenling moving around. All of my vassals just seriously doing a lot of damage still every turn, which is crazy. How far are we off getting Chaos Knights? We're on population surplus 7. So that's quite good. Oh, I'm losing my voice here. gonna probably move more towards Balthazar Gelt, although actually saying that, probably a bad idea because he's gonna start replenishing now. Or is he? Depends if they're allied. No. They don't have any allies. So they're not gonna replenish, but they're also not gonna take attrition. I guess that'll be fine. Maybe if we march all the way to Fort Yakova or Jakova, don't know how that's supposed to be said. I'm so used to saying things wrong in war game, probably getting things even more wrong in this game, but there we go.
Ready.
Right, Tamar, let's use you to assault one of these units. Never mind, we'll move on to the next turn. So the Empire gonna be heading back. Zavastra taken over by the vampires. Really tempted to get like all of my vassals to focus on Kislev. Those savages. The orcs are coming. Not the sophisticated bunch that hangs out in captured dwarf holds, but the more rural boys that wander the southern badlands. Yes, a nomadic horde of extra fighty savage orcs are close and could threaten your forces. Best be proactive against this lot before Mork or Gork leads them in them right into your realm. Okay, I guess it doesn't actually matter. Or is that the Skull Takers here? I guess like a singular army isn't actually a problem for me. That's the thing. It's more when there's like multiple like full stacks that I have to be worried. Right, so Siegfeld, by the time he gets down here, might have a chance to just wreck Zavastra. So I might do just that. We might try and take down Hochland on the way. And what I'm going to do with Tamar is actually start heading him towards Siegfeld's army, and we're going to deploy on the way to get more experience. Okay, so moving on again, we've moved on like at least 10 turns this episode. It's been pretty crazy, but I guess it's just a lot of movement, and I think they just got a successful assassination there, which absolutely sucks. So yeah, assassination is success. That's going to be four turns wounded. Going to get Archeon to attack Karak Ungor. And wow. Okay, so we'll get a battering ram and some siege towers. And I guess we'll have to fight this one on the battle map eventually, because the balance of power is very much in their favor. Like, they do have longbeards with great weapons, which are armor piercing, so really good actually against my units, but their melee attack is very low in comparison. You can see the melee attack of my chosen with great weapons is 58 right now, whereas their melee attack for longbeards is 28. We've got old grumblers, what does that mean? Respected for their great age, superior courage, and length of their facial hair, longbeards have an encouraging effect on their allies. So, leadership, should the Lord be absent. Okay. So they act like heroes. If the hero isn't there, if there isn't one there. Right, so we're just going to continue that siege. Once we get some siege equipment, we can definitely take them down. I do need to worry about this massive army of the dwarves. I have no idea what's in it. We're going to move on Sigvald. He's not in range to attack Hochland this turn, but Hochland's busy running around in attrition, so that's fine. Can we go to Zavastra? I mean, still the quickest way to get to Fort Yakova, so I think we might do that. We'll put him onto Force March as well. There we go. Right, so since we can't move Tamar, again, that's another skipped turn. We are still sieging Karak Ungor, and this army is still hanging out in Kazid Irkalaz. But unfortunately, guys, that has been my time. So, next turn, we can siege Karak Ungor on the battle map. But for now, that's all. So thanks for watching. Hope you enjoyed it, and I'll see you in the next episode. Goodbye.